We Die Alone by David Howarth. On Murat Seuil. Pascal, 1623-1662. Author's note. I heard the bare bones of this story during the war, soon after it happened, and I mentioned it briefly in my book, The Shetland Bus. All that I knew about it then was based on a report which was written in a Swedish hospital by a man called Jan Baalsrud. It was a graphic report, but Baalsrud was very ill when he wrote it, and it left a lot unsaid. One could see that there was much more in the story, some things which Baalsrud had forgotten, and others he had never known, although he played the main part in it. But it was not until 10 years later that I had a chance to talk it all over with him, and persuade him to come with me to the far north of Norway where it happened, to try to find out the whole truth of it. Now that I have found it out and written it down, I'm rather afraid of being accused of exaggeration. Parts of it are difficult to believe. But I've seen nearly all the places which are mentioned in this book, and met nearly all of the people. Not one of the people knew the whole story, but each of them had a most vivid recollection of his own part in it. Each of their individual stories fitted together and also confirmed what Baalsrud himself remembered. Some minor events are matters of deduction, but none of it is imaginary. Here and there I have altered a name or an unimportant detail to avoid offending people, but otherwise I am convinced that this account is true. Chapter 1. Landfall. Even at the end of March, on the Arctic coast of northern Norway, there is no sign of spring. By then the polar winter night is over. At midwinter it has been dark all day. At midsummer the sun will shine all night. And in between, at the vernal equinox, the days draw out so quickly that each one is noticeably longer than the last. But the whole land is still covered thickly with ice and snow on the very edge of the sea. There is nothing green at all, no flowers or grass, and no buds on the stunted trees. Sometimes there are clear days at that time of year, and then the coast glitters with a blinding brilliance in the sunlight. But more often it is swept by high winds and hidden by frozen mist and driven snow. It was on that coast, on the 29th of March, 1943, that this story really began. On that day, a fishing boat made landfall there, 6 days out from the Shetland Islands, with 12 men on board. Its arrival in those distant enemy waters, in the third year of the war, within sight of a land which was occupied by the Germans, was the result of a lot of thought and careful preparation. But within a day of its arrival, all the plans which had been made were blown to pieces, and everything which happened after that, the tragedies and adventures and self-sacrifice, and the single triumph, was simply a matter of chance, not the outcome of any plan at all, but only of luck, both good and bad, and of courage and faithfulness. That particular day was sunny, as it happened, and the 12 men watched it dawn with intense excitement. It is always exciting to make the land after a dangerous voyage, the more so when one's ship approaches the land at night, so that when daylight comes, a coast is revealed already close at hand. In that landfall, there was an extra excitement for those men, because they were all Norwegians, and most of them were about to see their homeland for the first time since they'd been driven out of it by the German invasion nearly 3 years before. Above all, here was the supreme excitement of playing a dangerous game. 8 of the 12 were the crew of the fishing boat. They had sailed it safely across 1,000 miles of the no-man's land of ocean, and had to sail it back when they had landed their passengers and cargo. The other 4 were soldiers, trained in guerrilla warfare. Their journey had 2 objectives, one general and 1 particular. In general, they were to establish themselves ashore and spend the summer training the local people in the arts of sabotage. In particular, in the following autumn, they were to attack a great German military airfield called Bardufoss. In the hold of the boat, they had 8 tons of explosives, weapons, food, and Arctic equipment, and 3 radio transmitters. As the day dawned, they felt as a gambler might feel if he had staked his whole fortune on a system he believed in, except, of course, they had staked their lives, which makes a gamble even more exciting. They believed that in a Norwegian fishing boat they could bluff their way through the German coast defenses, and they believed that with their plans and equipment they could live ashore on that barren land in spite of the Arctic weather and the German...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.